Hello students, now we are going to discuss another property of the atomic nucleus, that is the nuclear magnetic dipole moment. As you all know that when a charged particle moves in a closed path, it produces magnetic field. So because proton is a positive charged particle and it is moving inside the nucleus, so due to the orbital motion of the proton and the spin motion of the proton, the orbital motion produces the orbital angular momentum and the spin motion produces the spin angular momentum, where they both results in the magnetic field. Due to the production of the magnetic field, there would be magnetic dipole moment inside the nucleus, which will be called as the nuclear magnetic dipole moment. So here we consider the proton is having a charge of positive E and it is circulating about the nucleus with a force having frequency nu, and the current will be given by, the current we know is given by charge upon time, that is charge upon time period. So, and we know that 1 upon time period is equal to frequency, so we say that I is equal to E nu, which is equal to E upon T. So since the current loop possesses a magnetic momentum, which is called the orbital magnetic moment, dipole moment, which is represented by mu L. So mu L, that is the orbital magnetic dipole moment, is given by the formula current into area of the loop into permeability of free space. So that is why mu L is equal to mu naught, which is the permeability, I is the current, and A is area vector, is the area of the loop. Since the proton is moving in a circular path, so the area is the area of the circle, which is given by pi r square into the r cap unit vector. And we know that the proton is moving in a circular path, so time period will be equal to distance upon time, where the distance will be the circumference of the circle, which is equal to 2 pi r upon v, is the velocity with which the proton is moving. So substituting the value of t equal to 2 pi r in this equation, we get mu l is equal to mu naught e v upon 2 pi r into pi r square into r cap. So here pi and pi, r and r gets cancelled. So we get the resultant mu naught e v r upon 2 into r cap. For our simplifications, we multiply and divide by the mass of proton. Now, why did we multiply the mass? We multiplied because we know that the product of mass, velocity and the radial vector gives us the angular momentum. So instead of mpvr, we write the angular momentum L vector. So we get the relation mu L is equal to mu naught E L vector, where L vector is L into r unit vector upon 2mp. So the final result we get is mu L is equal to GL into EL vector upon 2MP, where GL is called the orbital gyromagnetic ratio, whose value is assumed to be 1, where the permeability of the free space was assumed to be 1. So we get this final result. Similarly, the proton is also spinning and it is having a spin orbital angular momentum, due to which magnetic field would be produced, and similarly we will get the magnetic spin dipole moment. So we get the relation mu s is equal to, instead of gl we have here have gs e upon 2mp into s vector. S is the spin angular momentum. So for proton, the value of gs is 5 + 5.5855, and it is having a positive sign, so the direction of mu s and s are parallel to each other. And for neutron, the gs value is 3.823 with a negative sign, which implies that the direction of the spin dipole moment is anti-parallel to the spin angular momentum. They both are in opposite direction to each other, where gs here in this spin magnetic dipole moment is called the spin gyromagnetic ratio. So if we want to calculate the total magnetic dipole moment. So the total value mu will be given by the addition of mu L and mu S. So when we substitute the values, we get E upon 2MP GL into L vector plus GS into S vector. So for simplifications, we get mu is equal to G into L plus S into E upon 2MP, where G is called the gyromagnetic ratio of the nucleus. After simplification, we get that this G value has the formula of half of GL plus GS plus half of GL minus GS into L into L plus 1 minus S into S plus 1 upon I into I plus 1, where GL and GS are the gyromagnetic ratios of the orbital and spin factors, and L is the orbital angular momentum, S is the spin angular momentum, and I is the total angular momentum. So we get that in place of L plus F, we substitute I. So we get total magnetic dipole moment mu is equal to G into I vector into E upon 2MP. So if we substitute the values of I, where I, you know that for proton it is represented as the half integral multiple of H bar. So if we substitute half H bar for I, we get mu N is equal to E H cross upon 2MP, and the value comes out to be 3.152 into 10 raised to power minus 8 electron volt meter square per Weber, and this mu N is called as the nuclear magneton. So this is the magnitude value of the nuclear magnetic dipole moment, and which is also known as the nuclear magneton. And the nuclear magneton is only contributed due to the unpaired proton or neutron present in the the angular momentum is only contributed due to the unpaired nucleon present inside the nucleus. So this was all about the nuclear magnetic dipole moment. So next property that we are going to study is about the electric quadrupole moment. What do you understand by electric quadrupole moment? Electric quadrupole moment means that we know that the shape of the nucleus is considered to be spherical. but if we say that the shape of the nucleus is not spherical, it is deviating from its spherical nature, and with what percentage or how much it is departing from its spherical distribution, that departure of the spherical distribution is measured by the quantity electric quadrupole moment. So it is shows that electric quadrupole moment measures the departure of nucleus from its spherical symmetricity. So let us consider that we have placed a proton, positive charge proton, in the three coordinate system x, y, z, and it is placed at a distance small r from the origin O, and we have to calculate the potential at point P, which is placed at the z axis. So the distance from A to P is referred to as R naught, and the distance from O to P is called the R. Or we can say that the radial distance from O to P is R, and from A to P is represented as R naught. So if we calculate the potential at point P on z axis due to the positive charge at A, we will be given by V is equal to 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught into Q upon R. So Q here is the positive charge on the proton E, and the radial distance from A to P is R naught. So we had substituted R naught. Now we know that since this proton is inclined at an angle theta with respect to z axis, so this R naught will be given by the formula R naught square is equal to R square plus small r square minus 2R small r into cos theta. And we know that this radial vector small r is lying in the three coordinate system, so it would be represented as R is equal to x square plus y square plus z square under root. That is the distance of charge from the origin. So substituting the values, we get the potential is 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught E upon R square plus R square minus 2 r small r cos theta under root.
So taking out r square common, and here it is a factor of square root, so square and square root get cancelled to get one value, one positive power of r. So you get 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught e upon r 1 plus r square by small r square minus 2 r upon capital R into cos theta under root. Now taking this bracketed term in the numerator, we get a negative half coefficient. So we get 1 by r square minus 2 r upon r cos theta raised to power minus half. So taking out r upon r common, we get 1 plus r by r into r by r minus 2 cos theta whole to the power minus half. Expanding this term binomially, so we get the terms 1 plus r upon r cos theta plus r square by r square into 3 by 2 cos square theta minus half plus r cube by r cube into 5 by 2 cos cube theta minus 3 by 2 cos theta, and so on higher order terms. So since there was a factor of e upon 4 pi epsilon naught at the outside, so we multiply the equation with all the terms of the binomial expansion, and we get the potential equal to e upon 4 pi epsilon naught r plus e small r upon 4 pi epsilon naught r square cos theta plus e r square upon 4 pi epsilon naught r cube into 3 by 2 cos square theta minus half plus so on higher order terms. So we are mainly concerned about the first three terms. The first term, that is the e upon 4 pi epsilon naught r, in this the coefficient of 1 upon r corresponds to the monopole moment. Secondly, the second coefficient of 1 by r square, that is e r upon cos theta 4 pi epsilon naught, corresponds to the dipole moment, which is along the z axis. Similarly, the coefficient of 1 by r cube, which is the e r square upon 4 pi epsilon naught into 3 by 2 cos square theta minus half, is the z quad component of the electric quadrupole moment. So our main aim was to calculate the electric quadrupole moment. So we are writing the coefficient of 1 by r cube as q, which is called the quadrupole moment. So q is given by e r square upon 4 pi epsilon naught 3 by 2 cos square theta minus half. So this equation is in the MKS system. But when we consider the CGS system, 1 by 4 pi epsilon naught takes a value of 1 numerical value, because in MKS 1 upon 4 pi epsilon naught is 9 into 10 raised to power 9. So in CGS system, we get E r square 3 by 2 cos square theta minus half. So taking half common, we get E r square by 2 into 3 cos square theta minus 1. Again, if we look at this diagram, we know that cos theta here is, this is the z value and this is the r value. So we can say this cos theta will be equal to z upon r. So cos theta is equal to z by r. Now substitute the value of z by r in this cos square theta. So you get q equal to e r square by 2 3 z square upon r square minus 1. So we get, multiplying by r square, we get e by 2 3 z square minus r square. So we can say that the nucleus has finite value. Q value is dependent upon 3 z square and r square. E is constant, z is not constant, r is not constant. These values are varying with the rectangular components x, y, z. Whatever the value of x, y, z will be there, Q will have some value. But if we say that our proton or the nucleus, that the proton is placed symmetrically inside the nucleus, so we can say that x square will be equal to y square will be equal to z square. So that will be the 1/3 of the r square. So if we take this quantity, z square is equal to 1 by 3 r square, we can write r square is equal to 3 z square. And if it is placed symmetrically, then 3 z square minus r square will be equal to 0. So that is why we say that the q is equal to 0. Means that if proton is symmetrically placed, then q will be equal to 0. It will not have any quadrupole moment. But if it is not placed symmetrically, it will definitely have some value of the quadrupole moment. Now coming to the quantum mechanical viewpoint of the electric quadrupole moment. This calculation was all by classical mechanics. Now in quantum mechanics, what we say? We say that we have a probability of finding a particular nucleon, either a proton or a neutron, at any place. Let it be at a point. If we say that we have a probability of finding the proton at this place, then that probability would be given by the square of the wave function. So we can say that sigma, which is the nuclear charge density in the volume element d tau at the point zr, then q, that is the quadrupole moment according to this equation, q equal to e by 2 into 3 z square minus r square, will be given by half. We have to take the total contribution, so we have integrated. Instead of the charge e, we had put charge density. Since it was charge density per unit volume, so we had multiplied this expression by the volume element d tau. So charge is equal to charge density into volume element d tau into 3 z square minus r square. So sigma is charge upon volume. So the charge can be written as ze, and the volume, total volume element, can be written as integral of the small volume element dv. So now, substituting the value of sigma, we get q is equal to half integral of ze upon integral of dv into 3 z square minus r square d tau. Solving this equation, we can say that this is equal to the z times the expectation value of the average expectation value of 3 z square minus r square. So again, if the neutron is placed symmetrically, then 3 z square will be equal to r square. So we will get q equal to 0. So both quantum mechanically and classical mechanically, we reach at the same result. For spherically symmetric, the electric quadrupole will be equal to 0. Now if we suppose our nucleus is imagined to be ellipsoid, it is elliptical. So if it is imagined to be ellipsoid of revolution with diameter 2b along the symmetric axis and 2a at right angles to the axis, means that if it is a ellipse having a major and minor axis of 2b and 2a, then the q value will be given by the equation 2 by 5z b square minus a square. So if it is a complete sphere, then this a will be equal to b, and if we substitute a equal to b, then b square minus a square will be equal to 0. So q will be equal to 0 for a sphere a equal to b. So when we take an oblate spheroid in which a is greater than b, if a is greater than b, means this is an oblate spheroid for a greater than b, since minus a square will be greater than b square, so we will say that the q will be a negative value. So our electric quadrupole moment will take a negative value. But if it is a prolate spheroid in which b is greater than a, or we say that a is less than b, then what will happen? The b square will be greater than a square, and it will lead to a positive value. So our electric quadrupole moment will take a positive value. So seeing all this, we can conclude that the electric quadrupole value ranges from 10 raised to power minus 30 to 10 raised to power minus 28 meter square, and these values are in the order of the nuclear area. So we can say that electric quadrupole moment is to measure how much a nucleus is departing from its spherical symmetricity. So generally it is found that the nuclei which are having the total angular momentum 0 and half, they have the ellipticity of the nuclei to be 0, means they are completely spherical in nature. There is no electric quadrupole moment. So I think you must have understood both the nuclear magnetic dipole moment and the electric quadrupole moment. Thank you.